Okay, we can talk about it now if you want. Yeah. All right, having a quorum present, I'll call to order the December 2nd meeting of the Historic Landmarks Commission. First item on the agenda is public comment. Any member of the public may address our commission on any project that is not on our agenda today. I do not have any public speaker slips, so I'll close public comment and ask for approval of the minutes of the Historic Landmarks Commission meeting of November 18th, 2015.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion by Arias, a second by Mahan. Under discussion, are there any additions, corrections, or clarifications to the minutes?
Nope.
Anybody?
Nope.
Nothing? Okay, that's good. Good news. All right, all in favor of the minutes as presented?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstain. Motion, let's see, Sudin abstains from item, wasn't there one? Cabrillo?
Lower Milpas?
Yes.
And the boy abstains from it.
Was yeah.
No, abstains from item number 9.
It was the archaeological report.
It must be item 3.
And I abstain from item 9.
And Arias abstains from item 9.
However, I watched it on TV.
Okay. All right. The consent agenda. Ms. Kaufman.
Item A, 1601 State Street. Approved as submitted for review after final. Item B, 27 East Coda Street. Project design and final approval as submitted. Item C, 721 Chapala Street. Project design and final approval is submitted. Items A and C were reviewed by Commissioner Mahan. Item B was reviewed by Commissioner Lavoie.
What was the action on item B again? Project design approval and final?
And final.
Great.
Is submitted.
Okay. Do I have a motion to ratify the consent calendar? I have a motion by Drury.
Second.
Second by Winnick. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion carries. Next item on the agenda is the announcements or any requests by applicants for continuances and withdrawals. Anything that we should be aware of on City Council, Planning Commission, or Parks and Rec Commission? Ms. Kaufman?
Commissioner Murray will be absent and Commissioner Schellenberger will be late.
Okay. All right. Does the Commission have any announcements?
I have a request. I would like to have make sure that we get reports from Commissioner Schellenberger regarding the signing ordinance. I think it's very important that the commission be informed of the results of every meeting.
Okay. Mr. Lamone, did you have something to add to that?
Yeah, I do want to follow up. The citywide signage program was presented to City Council last week, and they did actually deviate slightly and approved a blue parking background, which is a little bit different than what our subcommittee came up with and this commission recommended. But I don't think overall that it was a major change.
No.
So now the question is funding it and getting them be installed.
Right.
Good.
All right. No other announcements? And then we'll ask for subcommittee reports. Are there any reports from subcommittees that met in the last 2 weeks? Nothing? Okay. Then we'll go to our first item on a regular agenda. It's a discussion item on meeting protocol. Mr. Lamont.
Mr. Chair, I've asked Ms. Kaufman to lead the discussion today, and we're both available to have discussion after the presentation.
Okay. Ms. Kaufman, you have the floor.
So today we're going to talk about HLC meeting protocols. And this is an overview of the topics we'll be discussing, just a breakdown of how meetings are conducted. So an item will have a presentation from an applicant where they describe what the project is, and then staff is allowed to make comments if they have any supplemental comments on the project to give background. And then the commission will have questions for staff or the applicant, public comment session, and then individual commissioner comments leading into a motion.
That's a little different than what we have on the wall there. We usually do public comment right after the presentation and then questions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if I can comment on this. This was primarily an extension of an ABR discussion where they wanted to actually have this type of conduct direction on agendas. and they've requested that we place these type of information because some often new users or new applicants don't know the process and they get an agenda and not realize that there's going to be a series of steps involved. So we can adjust these steps according to that.
Whichever that, way you want us to do it.
That is... Part of the request is, do you agree that this information should be placed on agendas? And we're going to get into actually meeting how we set agenda times okay. also.
Okay. So this speaks to time management rules. The chairperson has a discretion to limit the applicant's presentation, the initial presentation, to 10, 15 minutes maximum. There's also possible discussion to limiting the presentation to a third of the agendized time. The chairperson can limit public comment to 2 minutes and request that no repetitive comments be made by subsequent speakers. And the chairperson can then give direction to the commissioners to focus their comments on major specific design issues and can also initiate straw votes and clarify if there's consensus or agreements.
Instead of 10 to 15 minutes maximum, I think it would read better if it just said 15 minutes maximum. 10 to 15, which is it, 10 minutes maximum or 15 minutes maximum? So 15
just,
minutes maximum.
It's a range. I mean, this is part of the discussion. If you, you know, have a preference or if you choose to make it a third of the discussion time, but we can...
The ABR has indicated for us to place on their agenda that the maximum presentation time will be one third of the allocated time.
Uh-huh.
Perfect.
If that, if you want to deviate, you're welcome to do that. Every board and commission is allowed to set their own rules.
I think that makes sense.
I think a third makes sense.
Yeah, and it would be helpful if on the agenda you outline what that third is so that when the applicant gets the agenda, they know how to figure that out. I know it makes a little bit more work for you, but, you know, you set the schedule. You know, say the item 2 starts at 2 o'clock. Well, the next item then starts at 2:25. What's one third of that? Let the applicant know on the agenda what that time is, if it's, you know, 10 and a half minutes or whatever.
I mean, it's only abused by a few.
Along those lines, I might as well introduce this concept too. There was some concern, I'll let you speak now after this, the ABR also was concerned about PowerPoint presentations and having them be essentially a duplicate of presentation that you would see visuals and then I have to also focus on the plans, and the ABR was actually considering limiting those type of presentations as part of that limit so you wouldn't have the redundancy, and they tended to want to focus on the plans themselves rather and trying to limit the PowerPoints. So we have not actually instructed applicants that their PowerPoints must be of a certain length, and that would be part of this discussion if in fact you want to place limits.
There are two things that I think are very important to the public, and that would be that you may or may not initiate straw votes. Straw votes have come back to haunt us.
Uh-huh.
And you have to be very careful about that. And also I would ask that the chair be very flexible about the 2 minutes, because some people aren't used to speaking in public and they're very nervous, and others are much more polished. And if a project is really complex, 2 minutes goes very fast before you can say lots of things. So I would say that both those mays are very important to be underlined, that the chair uses good balance in running the meeting. Also, I have a bug that bothers me, and that is when we're handed complex plans and we're trying to look at things and they're trying to show things and finding the pages and things like that. It's very important that we be able to know where things are. And sometimes it would be helpful if we got the plans in advance or comments that are being made in advance.
Or just that they identify where they're turning to.
Yeah.
Otherwise it's coming helps. Through
the information in a large.
Well, Mr. Chair.
Commissioner Drury.
Mr. Chair calls out page numbers generally on those big plans. So
after you write it out.
That is the most helpful thing. So at least we know at this end of the table, the page number.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, lots to talk about there. I mean, and, you know, with respect to the PowerPoint, presentations and calling out page numbers. If it's a PowerPoint presentation, then everybody can focus on the thing that's being discussed, and that is helpful. And there have been projects that a PowerPoint presentation is very beneficial, and the commission has mentioned, you know, very nice presentation sort of thing. Whether or not the plans are or a duplicate of what is on the PowerPoint, that's, you know, people will just print out their PowerPoint slides, and, you know, why waste the paper when it's up there on the screen? So I don't know how the commission feels about PowerPoint presentations, but I personally feel that sometimes they are very helpful, and sometimes they do help the commission focus on what is being discussed. To me,
they're a little more than PR and take up valuable time and actually looking at what's being presented. I mean, quite often it's just eyewash to make you feel good, and then the project comes in and you go, who prepared this? So limit it as part of 10 to 15 minutes. I think I'm right.
No.
I'm muted.
So it'll be included as part of their presentation time if they choose to.
However they wish to present the project, that's included in their time. And public comments, if you're an employee or a member of a board of directors, you are not public. You are representing the applicant. Case in point, the Natural History Museum, when they got every staff person to come up and say they love the project, that's not public comment. I'm sorry.
It depends on how tight that affiliation is. Definitely staff is not public comment. Speaking to PowerPoint presentations, maybe we just limit PowerPoint presentations to the concept level, period. And, you know, don't bring in a PowerPoint presentation for project design approval unless it's very straightforward, or don't bring in PowerPoint presentation for a final approval.
Yeah,
so that's
I guess since I won't be sitting here,
better say your piece.
But I might be sitting on the other side of the table. I would suggest not limiting it, and I think allow to use the discretion if they want to use it as part of their presentation time. Fine.
Yeah.
When the agenda is set,
you
know. So if it's a Natural History Museum and it's got a large agenda time because it's a complicated project, they can afford to fit in a PowerPoint presentation. If it's a little renovation project on Korea Street, that, you know, it's a two-family or whatever, just very small, they won't have time to. So organically, it won't happen.
They won't do it.
You'll also be seeing new technologies that will involve 3D models that are something what helpful now, and where you can rotate.
Right, and there's no way to do that other than on
the screen. Exactly, and so we've said that that's an alternative to even story polls, where you, as a, and a model, so you can see the building in different perspectives.
One other point is, I think it would be valuable if once in a while each commissioner watched a rerun of this organization, because very often if you're watching, you can't read what the plans are. You can't see the plans. They're vague. They're not clear. And part of our job is to serve the public and inform the public, and we need to be able to speak plainly and also have very good visual view of what's going on. And sometimes that doesn't happen, and I don't know how to make it happen, but it's something that should be looked at, because there is a public that watches this.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, no, I've sat and watched some sometimes, and it's very frustrating because it's like, hey, speak up, or, you know, I can't hear you, or I can't see the plan. So I know
what are you guys laughing about?
Yeah,
that was what was last time.
Yeah.
You sat there and laughed, and I thought, what are you laughing at? You
know? Okay, just for the sake of time, I'll keep going. Ironically.
Just kind of a little bit of
2 o'clock.
Okay. Do my best, but this is kind of our formula for when we are creating agendas, looking at the size and type of project, how controversial it is, and how much public comment will be brought forth. If too much time allocation is given, it requires recesses. So we really try to right size it, but we want to avoid, you know, having agendas, fall behind. We want things to be accurate. So we did a sample assessment of agenda items. So we looked at items from the beginning of the year through July 1st, 97 total items. 55 of the items were within or below time allocation. This is within 10 minutes of the agendized time. So 65% within range. We couldn't analyze 12 of those items because they were the last items on the agenda. So we can't really say how much time we intended for that item to be reviewed. 24 of the items, so majority of the over the 10 minute items were between 11 to 20 minutes over the agendized time. Four were 21 to 30, and two were 31 to 40, and none went from 40 to 60. So that's good.
That's pretty good.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's actually, if I could report, it was better than the ABR. The ABR had four projects that were over an hour.
Oh my difference. God.
And so obviously when you have that happen to your agendas, and they obviously begin later in the day, so they're staying into the 8 or 9 hour, and that's what generated some of this discussion. Was it staff that was doing this, or were they talking too much or not allocating enough time? And so we did agree that there were some larger projects that we probably should give at least an hour, hour 15 minutes, because they're, they tend to be well attended and so forth. So what we're carefully looking at projects just to know that, we, again, we don't want you to feel like you're not getting enough adequate time. And you've let me know and let us know when you don't think that has happened. Yeah. And we will adjust it based on your requests.
Back to the four items max per agenda for public comment, when you know that there's going to be lengthy. And you usually know that when there's going to be lengthy public comment when it's a big project. I suggest maybe three noticed items per max agenda.
You're going to make a lot of people really unhappy.
Okay, that's what I was thinking.
No, I don't think there should be a limit, because if you get your project in and you've promised your client you're going to be on a meeting on a certain date, you should not get bounced because you anticipate public comments.
Mm-hmm. Or there's more than, four.
Just grin and bear it,
Mr. Chair, there's also a practical reality is that our staff has limited amount of time to prepare larger projects for noticing, and so we do that ourselves to try to
leave
limit
it for then.
How many agendas and notices we put out.
Commissioner.
We do make exceptions on occasion, because architects can be very pushy. Persuasive is the word?
Persuasive.
Okay,
is that's a better word. Persuasive.
The landscape architects are never
persuasive. Some of us are pushy.
Yes, Commissioner Drury.
So generally, you have less than 2 weeks between meetings to get these projects noticed.
Well, we actually have it down to a science. About 19 days are required in order for us to complete the zoning reviews, and for Joanna to complete a notice in order to get in the mail and get it on an agenda. So people do need to have foresight to put in a project in, and if we miss that, believe me, it becomes a more of like a month delay, and that, again, it causes a problem with applicants.
And by the way, kudos to staff for getting the agenda and all of the information to us, considering there was a four-day weekend with Thanksgiving, so that was very good.
Well, they worked all weekend.
Didn't they? Oh, I didn't know that. A little else, huh? All right, continue. I'm sorry, Ms. Coughlin.
That's all right. So here's some time management goals. So staff tries to do their best to allow adequate time. And based on the types of projects, control limit presentations, it varies based on the size of the project, and give concise direction to applicants on the supportability of projects, and do big issues.
That, if I could comment on that, again, one of the concerns that ABR was struggling with, and I think it comes up here, is on the first constant reviews, we do really don't want you to get into the weeds yet. We want you to think big and think about this proposal as whether it's a good fit for the neighborhood and whether it's compatible. And one of the concerns that the ABR had is somehow feeling pressured on the first submittal to make an instant review of a project. And what we said as staff is there's nothing wrong with continuing a project for more information and more consideration of the project. And that could be in the form of going by the project site, because not all of you have had the opportunity to go by the site, and you might have a different perspective after seeing the project by then going and visiting the site. So again, it's although we want you to give a good direction on the first concept review, we realize that the second concept review might even be more telling and providing more direction.
Yeah.
Yeah, and this is just kind of expanding once again on these initial comments, looking at broad issues, site plans, site planning relationship to the site and neighborhood, using the project compatibility analysis as a tool and guideline consistency check. So giving advice and recommendations to provide concise and clear direction to applicants, recognize the public comments, provide basis for comments, respecting different perspectives, being fair and consistent, and making good, clear, understandable motions. So that concludes the presentation. If there's any additional comments.
Does anybody have any comments to add to that?
Mr. Chair.
Commissioner Drury.
In my experience on the commission, that we rise to that level or above consistently, especially at you as chair.
Thank you.
Mr. Chair, it would be nice to have these guidelines sent to us so we could have them to review them.
Right. I think after you massage them a bit for our comments, that would be helpful to have them
Send published. Them
and, you know, it's nice not to have a booklet of them, but just try and keep it as concise as possible. Perhaps even laminated like our favorite staff, Gabriela Feliciano, used to do. Not our favorite, but, you know, one of our favorites.
So, again, in summary, we are going to adjust the agendas to include more of a process of how meetings are conducted, and you'll see that as an additional element so the public is aware of how these meetings are conducted.
Can I weigh in, Mr. Chair?
Yes, Commissioner Wade.
On that one item that you brought up at the beginning, I think it's still important to keep the order that's on that page there with the public comment coming before the commission's questions, because I know as a commissioner it's helped me sometimes where I'll hear public comment. Mm-hmm. And if I, you know, because the applicant's not obliged to answer public comment, but as a commissioner I can say, oh, well, that was a good point, and I have that opportunity to then ask the applicant to answer that question. So I think the order that's up there makes sense.
While you're on that subject too, let me clarify something. Is public comment solely comments, or do they ask questions? I mean,
there is a form of comments that bring up questions.
Yes.
And I think what's lost sometimes in the translation of inquiry is the ability to direct staff to answer the questions. And I think it's important if you have a question that's being brought forward that you...
Which I often do.
Yeah, right. And can the staff address that if the commission can, if it's addressed to the city on behalf of the city, staff is required to answer process-related questions.
Not directed to the applicant per se.
Right, that's correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So, you know,
we would like the commission to ask us to answer the question rather than try to interrupt you and be...
But it's okay, like, say a question came up that I felt the applicant could answer.
Yes.
Then I'm entitled to ask that question because it's now my question.
Yeah. Right. That's correct.
So it gives you both choices.
Right. Yeah. To bring it up yourself.
So do we want to say public comment / inquiry or just public?
No, I think
just public comment. Fine. Great.
Yeah, because you don't want the public to think that the applicant's supposed to answer.
No.
And that's something I'm always very careful when I do, when I'm sitting there and make a presentation. Usually it seems to be at the county. I'll have somebody come in and make comments where they're trying to create a discourse out of the public, and I'm very careful not to let that happen.
And what we were trying to get at is that there are often comments that are raise issues, and it's important for the chair to try to lead the response and to say, yes, we're listening to that comment, but that should be directed to staff, and then they know it's not the commission's purview. They need to deal with staff on those issues.
Mm-hmm. One more thing.
Commissioner
LeWay. Our staff has done a wonderful job
managing us
and preparing us for these meetings, and I greatly appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you.
I would echo that for sure.
Agreed.
All right. Thank you, Ms. Kaufman, Mr. Lamone. Very helpful. All right, the next item on the agenda is a historic structures report, item 2. It's for 1300 block of East Yananali Street, 1095 segment ID. This is a review of a historic structure site report prepared by Applied Earthworks, Inc. The report concludes that the ashlar cut sandstone Montecito Yananali Street culvert, constructed in 1923, is eligible for listing as a structure of merit for the City of Santa Barbara and its historic resource for the purpose of CEQA. Okay, do you have anything to say?
More than usual today, actually. Staff does agree with the conclusions of the report.
Say it again, I'm sorry.
Staff does agree with the conclusions of the report that the minimally visible sandstone culvert is eligible for listing as a structure of merit and does not rise to the level of listing as a city landmark or on the California Register of Historic Resources or on the National Register of Historic Places. Staff does recommend that the HLC find that the proposed project's measures to minimize the impacts will reduce the impact to less than significant based on our municipal code 2222090, finding number 4, that utilizes the measures outlined in the MEA guidelines for historic resources, and that found that although measures 1 through 6 were not feasible for this project, measures 7, 10, 11, and 12 minimize the potential project impacts. And I did also want to note that Sheila Lodge, our liaison from the Planning Commission, sent several comments just clarifying some historical facts in the history section of the document, and I forwarded those to the consultant, and they're going to edit those in the final draft.
We didn't get a copy of that?
They were like certain dates and quotes that from the history section. So when she revises that, I'll forward it on so you can see that those clarifications will be made in the final draft. And her comments were taken into account. I also have here with me Stephen Greer, who's our environmental analyst. We worked closely together on this and this document.
Do you have anything to add?
No, I do not.
Very good. All right, I'll open public comment. I have no speaker slips, so I'll close public comment and ask the board if they have any questions. The commission, if they have any questions. Commissioner Arias, please.
I assume that this would be appropriate this time to ask questions on this document, right?
Yes.
Okay.
On the document, not the project. On the document, yes.
I'm sorry, what?
Do you have a little presentation?
Oh.
Yeah, I thought you...
Usually you don't, but go ahead. Okay, come forth, please.
Okay. Because I talked to Nicole, and I had some questions that I sent to her, and she was going to forward them to you, I believe, to you people.
I think Jessica talked to Jessica about your concern.
You did. Okay, thanks. I appreciate it.
We are talking about the document.
Not the project.
Not the project.
The document.
The document.
This document.
Your presentation, Ms. Grant, should be on the document.
On the document. I was asked, because the design review and approval is from the Architecture Board of Review,
right.
But for background, if you wanted me to give a quick 5-minute summary of what the project is, if that would be helpful for your review of the historic structures document.
I don't think so, because I think that's all pretty much contained in the document, enough for us to make judgment on the document itself.
Okay, great. Then
anybody feel differently?
Can I? Do you want to? Shall I start?
Go ahead. Sure. Ask your question.
Okay. Here we go, guys. You state that there's one bus stop in the area, and the document doesn't go into whether you're going to investigate more bus stops and if they're needed and planned and where. Question. The sidewalk is 5 feet, but yet when it comes to the bridge, it goes to 6 feet, and I don't see any reason why. And I think the document should explain that. You also mention on page 5 future channel widenings, and who decides, one, if it's feasible, and is there any proposal written on where this is going to occur and things like that so we know in advance? And then on page 5 also, you talk about every feasible effort should be made. And again, who decides if it's feasible? I mean, is it feasible for me to go rob a bank today?
Maybe.
Well, I don't, you understand what I'm saying.
Yes.
We need facts. you talk about the trees that are going to be removed. You said there are a lot of street trees that are going to be removed on Salinas and also in the site of the bridge. And it would be really handy if the document had some pictures of these trees. We know that you're trying to save the large sycamore. And again, it says at one point it's going to be, you have hired an arborist, but you don't identify who it is. And then you say it's going to have to be trimmed. And I think we need to know details on this tree. On page 26, you talk about chemical, physical, if appropriate. And again, who decides what's appropriate and what isn't appropriate? You need to identify the quality or the education of the person who's going to decide that. Also, on page 29, you speak about salvaging of significant material. Who decides what the material is significant, which material is significant, which material isn't significant? Again, you need to know what and who is going to do it. I talked to you about the trees and the sycamore tree being trimmed. You state there that some things are in the city right away. This eminent domain can be established against the city property, but it cannot be established against a park. So that is a question I don't know if you've gone into. I think that the measures that should be implemented, that part of the document was very well done, and I appreciate that. But I'm looking for specific identifiable things that are going to be done and how it's going to be done and who's going to do it. Just somebody, if we pick out, if it's feasible, you know, that doesn't work. You've got to be specific. This is a very important project, and it affects a lot of people, and it's in a very nice neighborhood, and it's got significant positive aspects to it. I'm sorry, I'm going into comments, but these items need to be addressed.
Is there any specific question you wanted the applicant or staff to respond to in that? I mean, you...
Well, I don't know if they were ready to, and I don't mean to, you know, throw you a...
Okay. And I'm going to ask, Ms. Grant, do you want to respond?
I can respond. I'm Jessica Grant, for the record, with the Public Works Department Project Planner. To respond, I'll quickly run down the list as I understand the questions. The first question was regarding a bus stop. Just to orient everybody or for viewers, this is projects in the East Side neighborhood. This is existing Five Points Roundabout. The Montecito-Yananali Bridge is right at this location. The closest bus stop to the project location is just outside of the Five Points Roundabout turn. There's about 65 buses that pass by this bridge per day, and it is along a bus route, very, very busy street. The second question was clarification of sidewalks.
I asked if more are planned or needed.
No, we would work with the MTD on that, but right now,
answer.
Correct.
You're going to work with the MTD.
The sidewalk question, the sidewalk varies on the bridge. It is 6 feet. It matches up with the 6 feet of sidewalk. On Salina Street, due to physical constraints, we're proposing a 5-foot sidewalk and 4-foot parkway. For future channel widening, again, this is a Safe Routes to School project, but we are, as part of our capital improvement program, looking at channel widening of Sycamore Creek. And the lower part of Sycamore Creek, the northern boundary, is essentially at this bridge and then goes all the way down mm-hmm. the ocean. But that is a separate project. But as we design this project, we need to look at that as a future reality. The tree removal, we do have an exhibit of the tree removal. We have been, our arborist is Bill Speedwack that we've been working with. There is an arborist report dictating what all the conditions were. I won't go into all those details. And David Black is our architect. And is the landscape architect, correct?
Right.
Did you want me to go over the sheets for tree removal?
No.
But we do have it documented, and the review that we need to go through is the street tree removal
advisory committee
for the removal, and we'll work with them. And we've been working with our arborists on replacements.
Are there plans also for replacements?
Correct.
You are replacing.
But we have to meet with that street tree advisory committee first.
Diligent committee.
And being reviewed by ABR.
Correct.
Both of them.
Yes. As far as for salvaging material, we will...
I would like to speak to that when I have an opportunity to the specific mitigation measures. When you
sure.
You can present what your position is and so add to that.
This just a moment of just clarification. Are we discussing the report still, or...
It's related responding to the report.
Okay, all right.
Because
thank you.
The questions
Judy.
Being
thank
brought
you.
Up.
So
as far as for salvaging material from the existing bridge, this is just a concept of what the bridge, future bridge, may look like. And as far as reusing some of the sandstone elements, we would look to put it at the sort of the entrances of the bridge railings. Mm-hmm. And then also potentially look at where the abutments would be as far as for reuse. As part of the recommendations in the historic structures report, we'd work on a physical conservation program report that would have those details on the reuse. And the other ones, I wasn't quite sure if I understood the correct question correctly on eminent domain. It had to do with our alternatives analysis of whether to have a cantilevered pedestrian facility, a separate pedestrian bridge, and that would look at needing property acquisition.
Let's see if she, okay. Commissioner Rios can clarify.
One of the problems I have is when you talk about the final report, the details of the report, the pages aren't there. So, you know, what I saw was that the paragraph that talked about street trees also talked about people had planted things within the city right away or things like this. And that was the question I asked, is whether they had established eminent domain or not. And I don't know, that would be a legal question that you would have to ask the city attorney.
Before we go to that question, I believe, I'm sorry, I didn't catch your name.
Steve Greer.
Steve Greer, I'm the environmental analyst for the city.
I think you wanted to comment also on the reuse of materials.
Yeah, I just wanted to indicate that the program, the conservation program, will be required to be approved by your body prior to, by the HLC specifically.
Okay.
That the historian will prepare prior to any removal and use of that material. So you will have an opportunity to actually review the program when it's developed and actually are required to approve that program before any work moves forward for the salvaging of that material. And that's specified in the conditions as we have now.
Okay. Good.
Could you clarify just exactly what the general scope of the conservation is, will be?
My understanding at this time is the attempt to be able to take the physical features from the exterior, which is the stones that have been cut, and reuse those on the structure. The actual, for you to make the determination, the requirements in the MEA actually indicate that the materials must be used on the same site and in public view. It doesn't describe exactly how that is to occur, but that's one of the requirements. The material just can't be stacked up in a pile and say, hey, there it is, look at it, it's there. It has to actually be reused functional in some way on that that new facility.
Okay, I'll have comments on that then later.
Commissioner Rios, continue.
You found where it says about sections of the area, privately owned fences, walls, and landscaping encroaching into city-owned right-of-way. That's my question about if eminent domain has been established or not. And you'd have to ask the attorney on that.
Yeah, I don't think, well, okay.
And the other thing, you talk about utilities being incorporated into the bridge, and then you say as practical on the bridge. Again, the thing that bothers me is the words of if feasible, if practical, if appropriate. Those are what I kind of refer to as weasel words. They can go this way or they can go that way. And I think documents that are going to affect this neighborhood to the extent that this will, you should be very specific and identify what's going to happen so people can't say, I never knew this, blah, 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 because then everybody loses. It's better to have things clear and concise in the beginning. So let's see. And again, it would be really helpful if there were page numbers on this. And if we actually had photographs of the trees that were going to be removed or things like that. Thank you very much.
You, Ms. Grant, have answered all of the questions. Okay. You were wanting clarification on the last few. So I think that has been addressed. Commissioner Lavoie,
did you spoke up.
Okay. Commissioner Vane,
My question was regarding the aesthetics of some of the trees. Many times arborists will get in there and they'll make cuts and so forth, and no one has addressed the aesthetics of the tree as to the shape and form and so forth. And they may go in and do a 10 or 20 year pruning job, and it's just too bad because you can't put anything back. And that's where I'm concerned that hopefully you'll have the landscape architect or someone who's qualified to work in conjunction with the tree person so that we can have, you know,
address it from an aesthetic standpoint, not just a practical. But yeah, I think that is important.
Practical is good, but aesthetics are important
too. Yeah. And not all arborists have an aesthetic eye.
Here, here.
Not this one in particular. I'm just saying, not all arborists.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chair.
Commissioner Lavoie.
On page 8, in the middle of the first paragraph, you refer to State Street as Estado Street. Do you have a document from the period calling State Street Estado Street? As I've been told, sitting here on the commission, that when Haley laid out State Street, called it State Street. And I can remember Commissioner Boucher many years ago rolling out of her chair laughing when a landscape architect called it Calle Estado. It was never called State Street. Yeah, it was never called Estado Street.
Right. Before that, it was called Main Street.
Main Street, yeah. Mm-hmm. So if you have a document, I'd love to see it.
My name is Colleen Hamilton.
Welcome.
Thank you. I am the senior architectural historian. I believe that I have seen a document with it used that way, but we will research that and make sure it is clarified.
On Haley's survey.
No, I understand that. I'm referring to more the earlier Spanish documents is where I believe I have seen it. Uh-huh. But nonetheless, you're right. We need to make sure that is accurate and provide a reference. A citation.
That would be helpful.
Okay?
Yes, please.
Thank you for bringing that up.
I'd be amazed if the Spanish would have called it State Street.
No, Estado.
Or Estado, yeah.
Estado.
They would have given it the Spanish name for state.
No, they wouldn't have called it state. It was a kingdom.
No, I know. That's what I'm saying. You would be very surprised if they gave it the Spanish name.
The Mexicans may have called it State Street, but not the Spanish.
All right. Any other questions? Or comments?
Any comments?
Comments?
Go ahead, comments. Commissioner Drury.
Yes, I'm once again appalled at the attack on our stone resources, starting with Mission Canyon, and now this. And I disagree completely with the conclusions of the report. Okay.
Commissioner Mahan?
No comment.
Commissioner Winnick? Comments or questions?
Yeah, I'm sad to see another really lovely little bridge go. But
that's progress.
It seems to be what's happening with all these bridge projects. So. I guess it would be nice if the reused material, like I know it's being documented and photographs will be available. It would be nice if the character of the reused material could somehow seem more like it was used originally. And I know we're not supposed to be commenting on the project itself, but that could just maybe be shared with ABR.
Okay.
I think it would be, I'm surprised Mr. Meehan didn't bring it up, but I think it would be nice if there were a plaque on this bridge indicating that it is a second or third generation bridge, whatever, you know. Pardon?
The mitigation?
Yeah, just so that, yeah,
included,
you know,
as a
in situ it is recognized as being, you know, altered. Obviously, people can go back to the report, but that takes legwork. If there's a plaque, then it's in situ, and people will remember that. Commissioner Lavoie, any comments?
I agree with the comment about loss of stone bridges. I understand the need to replace it, take it away. But I would much prefer that the material, as a bridge, as a stone arch bridge, what it is conserved and placed someplace else in a city public park where it will span whatever stream and or creek it could span, is much more conservation of the artifact than chopping it up and putting it into piers on the corners, which, while lovely, has nothing to do with an extant stone bridge. There's nothing about that pier that tells me that was part of a bridge, nor it's similar to taking down the Colosseum and building, you know, St. Peter's with the rock. There's nothing in the rock of St. Peter's that lets me know it came from the Colosseum other than history. So I would strongly recommend that the bridge be taken apart, numbered, and put back together someplace else where it's visible to the public.
Speaking to the conservation aspect of
the conservation aspect
of the report. Yeah. Commissioner Arias, anything to add?
Well, I went through the report mostly for accuracy and clarity and so that everybody could understand. I understand the need for the bridge. I know the area well. I agree, I hate to see the stone bridge go. But there are traffic problems up there. There's no other way to describe it, and I understand that. I just think that you want to go as carefully and as accurately and with as much clarity as to what you're doing so everybody understands and there's no confusion regarding this report. And I wish it didn't go, but I understand the need, unfortunately.
Commissioner Vena, anything to add?
No, nothing else to add. Thank you.
If it's all right, I'd like to speak to a couple of the comments.
Mr. Greer?
The MEA document that is referenced with the recommended measures that are being applied to the project allow the commission to make a determination that the project would be less insignificant as far as the impacts. And the item of relocating the bridge had been ruled out as infeasible due to the economic limitations of such a project, and the findings that are being presented are consistent with that. The 22.22.090 reference of the ordinance, item 4, is the finding that we would be asking for your approval for consistency with the recommendation from the urban historian. I do want to say that what was looked at was actually trying to design the new bridge with an arch feature to try to integrate the actual existing design into this new structure. The problem is, though, because of the existing volumes of water during flood conditions, that would reduce the ability for that new bridge to carry the volumes of water that we already know overtop that bridge considerably at times. So an effort was made to try to design the bridge or include in the design of the bridge these features in a similar way. But as I've just described, even trying to put small radiuses on the corners of the bridge was determined that would reduce the amount of volume and flow to a point that it wouldn't be feasible to meet the requirements for flood elevation and such that are created by that structure. So the what we're referring to as far as these measures you've referred to, they don't, and I certainly understand the position that we're not replicating the bridge in any way with this material, but the outline, the guidelines outline a requirement to use that material on the site, in on the existing site, not somewhere else. Doesn't these particular conditions do not allow for that material to be used in a different location if we're going to reference this particular component of the MEA. If we're going to look at a recommendation to relocate the bridge, that would be falling under 1 through 6, those areas of talking about relocation of the bridge. And I'm certainly not saying that's not a determination or recommendation that the commission can make, but that isn't actually consistent with what is being presented today. Another point is, in addition to what's been laid out in the document, the item 12 of those measures does allow your commission to add additional measures in on top of what we're recommending here to further address those impacts. So what I'm saying is, if there was a desire on the commission's part to use some of these materials somewhere else to make a smaller, replicate a version of the bridge with the same features, that would be under your purview using item 12 of the guidelines. So again, just wanted to try to give you an understanding of how the findings, the determinations, the measures that are being specified are in line with the ordinance today.
Mr. Chair?
Commissioner Chair.
I do have a question, maybe it's for the project, but where are the funds coming from for this project?
Safe Passage.
It's from the Active Transportation Program grant.
Federal money?
It is. It's a federal and state grant, but for this particular project, it's state funds from the Active Transportation Program. And then we've received from City Council about a $400,000 match.
Mr. Chair?
I have one thing too.
Is it related to that question? Commissioner Rios.
Also, there is a timetable that you have to adhere to, which the commission should know.
Correct. For the grant, in order to deliver this project, we have to have the environmental review done in the next, by June, and the project delivery it under construction by starting in spring of 2017. If we fail to meet those deadlines, we forfeit the grant. Mm-hmm.
I had what?
Oh, I'm sorry.
We did have something new in this document that we haven't done before, but it's like the suggestion by the historian to designate some of the other stone bridges in the city. So it's a new, because it doesn't really mitigate what's happening here, but it protects some of our other ones that may be in jeopardy in the future.
We will address that with the designation subcommittee.
Yes, but it's in the report, so when you accept that recommendation will move forward and we'll get active on this.
Thank you, Chair.
Would accept that recommendation. Commissioner Drury?
Just one more thing. I'm going to read, I think it's the sixth or seventh line under 7.3, item 2. It's a wonderful bureaucratic jargon. Demolition of the culvert will cause a substantial adverse change
and the significance of a historical resource. Yeah, it won't be there. That's a significant change. Thank you.
Yeah, that's why it's called substantial adverse.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Commissioner Rios.
I would like to see the document revised with my concerns and questions, if they're appropriate to be answered and incorporated into the document before we take an action on it. At this point in time, I think there are enough questions I have that I'm not comfortable with approving it. And I also certainly do support the existing structure minimization measures, the last paragraph on the unnumbered page, which talks about Rattlesnake Canyon Bridge as a city landmark and et cetera, et cetera. So I think that is a mitigation measure. But again, I want to get a most accurate document I can get out of this.
Mr. Chair?
Commissioner Lavoie?
I have a problem with burdening a project not before us with a designation. I'd like to make a motion for an indefinite continuance, directing the applicant and the historian to prepare a report that indicates conservation and relocation of the resource in its current configuration as a bridge, a stone arch bridge, reutilizing the stone facing only, and not necessarily the same width, on a different public location yet to be disclosed or decided upon, and accepting the current design, I guess with the exception of the reuse of the existing stone, but recommend native stone be used on the piers as indicated in the design, and that the appropriate questions from Commissioner Reyes be included in the document, and a removal of all of the, if feasible, conditions. Be more clear just what your intent is.
A removal of the word, if feasible.
If feasible.
Well, there's several different words that are used that make
or are called. Or condition those.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Second.
Make the ambiguous conditions stronger.
Second.
I had a motion by Lavoie, a second by Drury. Under discussion, is there any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed. What opposition? Drury? Abstain. Motion carries. Thank you. Do you want this back?
I will do that.
You can get a bunch. Here you go.
Stay on schedule. Okay, next item on the agenda is item 3. It is concept review of 1317 State Street. This is a proposal to apply waterproof coating over the existing stucco of the tower on the Arlington Theater. Action may be taken if sufficient information is provided. The project was last reviewed on July 29, 2015. I'm required to read those.
Noticed by the wrong architect?
Yeah, I somehow got myself into Mr. Peter's office.
I was wondering.
It's like, gosh, this one changed hands. we'll correct the record. Okay. So you're here twice
today.
Do
you want staff to correct that?
Yes, please. Okay. Edwards and Pittman, architect Richard.
Staff is directed to remove Mr. Peikert's name as the architect.
All right. The motion from July 30th, 2015 was continue 2 weeks with the following comments. Provide additional information on examples of other historic stucco vertical buildings that the product has been used to demonstrate its compatibility with the original material. The material color, gloss, sheen, and texture must match the original. If not known, perhaps paint and material analysis is necessary. Due to the urgency of the cracking, a timeline on the project should be provided. The HLC gave the project a 2-week continuance due to the urgency of the project to be completed prior to the rainy season. The motion was made by Mahan. It was seconded by Drury. It was an 8-0-0 vote. Marie was absent, and the motion carried. Please introduce yourself for the record and give us a brief presentation.
Richard Redmond from Edwards and Pittman.
Welcome.
Sorry it's taken so long to get back to you. We've done some research and had a report done actually on the stucco. And actually found it.
They have them.
By WJB and Associates, their architects, engineers, and material researchers. And they found that basically it's a two-coat stucco system, a brown coat and a scratch coat. The I believe they found a lot of voids in the scratch coat or the brown coat. Scratch coat was fairly solid. And then on top of that, there was kind of a layer of lime that's caused the paint actually to separate from the building. So with that in mind, we actually contacted D7, who's a waterproofing consultant down in the LA area, I believe at Pasadena, and they suggest this NeoGuard instead of the AVW waterproofing system. So we contacted NeoGuard regarding that use, and they suggested this NeoFlex, which is basically, it is an elastomeric, and I know that it brings up terrible images, but it's not going to sag, and it's not going to actually attract dirt. It's actually dirt resistance, and it's designed to go over, you know, there's actually a waterproofing system that's designed to go over stucco. And a lot of hotels have used it down in L.A., and I kind of gave a list of hotels in that document. And then as far as the cracks and everything, they're suggesting probably digging out the cracks and filling it with this Remay spun polyester fabric, and then do some sort of a polyurethane sealant on top of that for the large cracks. So this is their recommendation, and basically we're going to use it as a spray-on application. And I believe we can match any color of that building that we need to. But as far as the work, it's going to be a spray-on. It's got to be done by a contractor that's actually warrantied by the manufacturer. So he said that basically a lot of the problems they've had with elastomerics in the past are because of the applicator. That is it, and that's not a sagging application either. It's done with a roller, so it's not like it's, you know, sagging. But that was done with just the roller, and it's the nap that you're seeing on there. So the I believe the application is going to be spray on. It's going to be 10 mils thick. Prior to that, they'll do a water wash on the entire tower to kind of loosen up that lower layer and probably get rid of most of the paint on the building. So that's our proposal.
So it won't have the question.
Hold on, Commissioner Mahan. Any staff comments on this?
I think we're going in the right direction from where we were. I think
you've looked at the
material. I did. I looked at the materials proposal and the recommendations, and I think.
Okay. I'll open public comment. I have no speaker slip, so I'll close public comment. Ask the commission if they have any questions. Commissioner.
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Chair. Commissioner Mahan, I'm sorry. Let's start with
the commission. Oh, yes. So it wouldn't necessarily have this crinkly.
No. It, when they do a spray on, it'll come on absolutely smooth. So, and it has a dull finish to it.
Yeah.
That's nice. Commissioner Drury?
So I'm assuming that the unstable outer layer
lime.
Carbonated hydrated lime and minor Portland cement.
Will be removed.
Yeah, so that's going to be quite a project, right? I understand there has to be screening and so on. And
yes.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. And then
they've got a water blast.
You're going to find more cracks. And so I realize that the whole project is dependent entirely on this company with NeoFlex to fill in the cracks. And then for the bigger crack, bigger than 16th of an inch, there's another item that goes underneath that the stuff seals itself, too. Yeah,
that rebank material.
Thank you.
Commissioner Winnick, any questions?
No.
Commissioner LaVoie?
No questions.
Commissioner Gish, any questions?
No questions.
Commissioner Vena?
Okay.
How about comments? Commissioner Duran, any comments?
Yes, I really appreciate the thoroughness of this. It's what we needed to see. Thank you.
Okay, good.
Commissioner Meehan?
Yeah, I agree, and I think this is a much better material than what was first proposed. And I think it'll be acceptable. Lack of gloss and.
Mm-hmm. All right. Good. Commissioner
Winnick,
any comments?
I guess I probably should have asked that as a question, but you're starting to ask that too. So the samples are put in front of us in the sample board that any color could be matched. I'm presuming you're basically just matching what's there.
Yes.
And so then this is just showing us what the basic materials are, but that you actually would be matching what's there.
Yes.
So that's fine. I can support the project. And thanks for all the due diligence that you've done in response to us.
Commissioner LaVoie.
Which one of the four colors is that, remember?
There are a few colors on there, but.
The majority color. You're going to pick one.
Yes.
You get stick with
we're going to pick one. Probably this color.
The white, yeah. echoing thank you for an exhaustive and very informative report.
I think they did a good job.
They did a very good job, very thorough. You have my unreserved support for this.
Thanks.
Commissioner Rios?
All positive.
Commissioner Vena?
Don't. Mr. Chair, I do have one thing. Performance requirements for cured film. 98 miles an hour wind-driven rain.
It could happen this winter.
Hope that never happens.
Hope not. All right.
You know, that's
any other
questions? I have one.
Yes, Commissioner Ms. Hernandez.
Because of the concern we have with the cracking, maybe we should have some time constraints on the project, or do you have a timeline for the project we can
They'd
follow
like to get started
closely?
Right away. They're very concerned about the tower.
Yeah. Coming
when
rain.
Are they thinking it'll be complete?
I would have to check with the contractor.
Yeah, I think that would be helpful, just so we have that.
I think you're racing weather. Eventually, we're going to get something. You know,
sooner the better.
Well, they have the same sympathy that we have. I'm sure. Like the owner probably wants to get it done more than we do.
Oh yes, they very much do.
Tom, I'm looking for a motion.
The final approval of the project as submitted, making findings that. Yeah, I guess
to make
findings,
don't
I?
Do I?
Mm-hmm. It's a historic resource.
Oh, that's right.
It's the landmark findings that would.
Which?
I think it's the landmark findings that the repair will be towards the restoration of the building. I think that's the landmark. I don't know if they're in there.
Will not cause a substantial adverse change to the significance of the historic resource.
Yes.
And will in fact prolong its life.
Okay. I think you need to do all of them.
All of them?
Yeah.
Oh.
At least, no? Okay. Not visual impact, or okay.
No, because it doesn't change.
All right. We had a motion by LaVoie, a second by Meehan. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Motion carries. You're on your way.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.
Do you need this?
Yeah, we'll keep one of those.
Just one.
Waterfront parking. Oh, God.
Do you need this?
Oh, sorry. Sorry about that.
All right. Would you like this report back?
Actually, I got one.
Okay.
The next item on the agenda is 15 minutes away, so we will recess until 2:55 or until we have an app.
Or does Mr. Lamont need to lecture?
All it takes was Ms. Coughlin to give us a little.
I just put us ourselves into recess, so.
Are we off camera?
We are in recess, so I imagine we are off camera. We'll be right back.
Having a ball, I'm sick and tired of it all. So baby, now I'm ready to go steady with you. This single life is too tough, the road is getting too rough. So baby, now I'm ready to go steady with you. Yes, I know it's so, I've acted wrong. You've been sweet, so sweet, to wait this long. So here's to husbands and wives and matrimonial lives. I'm glad to say I'm ready to go steady with you. So here's to husbands and wives and matrimonial lives. I'm glad to say I'm ready to go steady with you. To go steady with you. I'm so ready for you.
Axel, could you make the
All right, we will reconvene the Wednesday, December 2nd meeting of the Historic Landmarks Commission. The next item on the agenda is item 4. It's waterfront parking lots, but before I do that, I need to reopen item 3 and announce that there is a 10-day appeal period of our decision. That appeal would go to City Council. So, having said that, we're back to item 4. This is a proposal for alterations to waterfront parking lots located at Ledbetter Beach, Harbor West, Garden Street, Chase Palm Park, East Cabrillo Boulevard, and West Cabrillo Boulevard to remove existing parking attendant kiosks or honor fee slot systems, ticket dispensers, and traffic arms, and install new automated pay systems with protective bollards. Also proposes new landscaping in areas where existing kiosks were removed, and 6 new ADA access ramps. Requires coastal development review. Action may be taken if sufficient information is provided. The Ledbetter and Harbor lots were reviewed by the Architectural Board of Review. All right, please introduce yourselves for the record and give us a brief presentation.
I'm Carl Triberg, the Waterfront Facilities Manager, and I'm joined by Teresa Lawler, our Engineering Technician.
Welcome.
Thank you. Your description was very thorough. An overview of our parking lots that we look after at the waterfront. These are the two Ledbetter and Harbor West lots. Those are the ABR lots. We went to ABR last week before last. Before you today, the Garden lot, the corner Garden and Cabrillo, what we call Chase Palm Park or Skater's Point lot, and in Cabrillo East and West by the Cabrillo Arts Pavilion.
Okay. Everybody oriented. Okay, we're on sheet 2.
In general, what we're proposing in all these lots and what we have partially implemented is the old pay stations were these big, tall platforms where you'd fold up dollar bills and insert them, 97 inches tall by 84 inches wide. We got a couple photos on some succeeding pages. And they're replaced with what we call the Luke is the brand name of the pay stations. You see these all over UCSB, a lot of public lots all over. There's thousands throughout California these days. Mm-hmm. Here's a photograph of one. The footprint is about 2x2 in a base and a concrete base. There's a sign associated with each, about 108 inches high. And then the units themselves are about 84 inches high. But this kind of puts them in context, the size of one to the other. So So I'll briefly go through each of the lots where we propose to put them. This is Ledbetter, that's an ABR lot, or waterfront lot, but viewed by ABR. This is Harbor West, which I believe is also ABR's purview. So the first lot is the Garden Street lot, located at the corner of Cabrillo and Garden. We have the visitor centers here in the corner. A lot of the tour buses queue up along there. Each of these locations I'll talk about where we've distributed the parking stations, or like to distribute the parking stations, pay stations. This is what they used to look like, these big things, and then this is what we're proposing in the different locations. And it's just some of them have a single station, some of them have two stations to handle the traffic or the number of people that may want to park at any given time. We've tried to distribute them throughout the lot so they're sort of equally accessible depending on where you park. This particular lot's received a bit more interest and a bit more use in the recent past. Here's another example of what was there and what we want to propose. This particular lot has a kiosk. Several of our lots do, but not all. We want to remove the kiosk and landscape the area. With these new self-pay stations, there's really no reason to have a kiosk there anymore. These are agave and aloe. These are some succulents we've been using in all of our landscaping. We just so happened to turn off the dolphin fountain this year and landscape it with these. So assuming it rains this year, we're going to have plenty of surplus plants where we can go and landscape this later in the year.
Okay, we're on page 7.
Chase Palm Park lot. Some people refer to Skaters Point. Skate park is right there. As you go in, we just have them kind of lined up, 1, 2, 3, and 4, as you walk out to the beach. The next page has some nice photographs kind of showing what they would look like.
Page 8.
The best example of what we're doing is down here, location 3. The old pay stations were right kind of on the bike path, quite large, kind of blocked the views quite a bit, and this is what we're replacing them with. And like I said, in other locations, we have two just in a couple different locations to try and make it easier for users. And then once again, this also has a kiosk, which we'd like to remove and landscape.
Okay. On page 9.
Cabrillo West, the west side of the Cabrillo Arts Pavilion. Once again, these were the old fold-up dollar bill pay stations replaced with two in each of these two locations. And then one of these we're just eliminating altogether, the one that faces the building. We feel that these two will serve the needs of the folks using that parking lot.
Just point out the locations real quick.
Yeah, right here as you drive in on the ocean side, that's this one. Mm-hmm. And then number 2, this is also facing the ocean down by the building itself. Number 3 is where the old self-pay station was adjacent to the building that's been removed.
We're on page 10.
And then the final one, the Cabrillo East lot. This is the Cabrillo Arts Pavilion right here, the west end, and then the east end of the lot. This is the one that provides access to all the folks using the volleyball courts down the beach down there. Once again, we had the two large self-pay stations, and we're replacing them with 2 units each with the expectation that that'll serve the public. And that's really the project in a nutshell. Pretty straightforward and simple. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Just a quick question while we're on this page. The ones that are UCSB, you purchase the ticket, and then you go back and put it in your car.
And we refer to that as pay and display.
So these are pay and display.
That's correct.
All right. I will open public comment. I don't
have a letter.
Actually, we do have a letter. This is from Sherry Ray. She'd like to relay her experience with one of the ticket dispensing machines that she had at the Cabrillo Pavilion. She didn't realize that it would cost to park. She had estimated the time to get there without paying to park. As she tried to load the machine rejected one after the other, and then it finally took them. This was not the way I wanted to enter a festive event, all stressed about what it took to feed the parking machine. If you intend to rely on these machines, then please make certain that they are much more efficient and accessible. By the way, I encountered one people in line at the event, and he said that he ended up using his card based on watching all my difficulties. Not everyone using the lots may have their card on them when they park their cars. If the kiosks are eliminated, please recycle them at local parks or in another way, perhaps even for sale to the public for use in gardens. There are some that are very lovely. And by the way, I will miss the interactions with fine individuals who staff them. This was given to us by Sherry Ray McKinney. Thank you for your consideration. All right, I will close public comment and bring it to the commission for questions. Commissioner Vena, do you have any questions?
No.
Commissioner Arias, any questions?
Not at this time.
Commissioner Lavoie.
Yeah. Just how do these conform to HLC guidelines?
Yeah, that's coming.
What was I didn't hear your question.
How do these conform to the HLC guidelines?
I can't answer that. These were approved in the past by HLC and ABR and their respective advisory boards. Obviously, they're quite large. They obstruct ocean views in many locations, and they were very difficult to use. People had to fold dollar bills up.
I know how these conform.
Yeah.
I'm asking, how do these conform?
And I can't answer that. I don't know.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
Commissioner Winnick.
I just want to ask you about, I guess, two things, color and location. So I see that you have yellow bollards, but in the old ones, they were green bollards. Could the bollards not be the same? Like, is this proposed four colors, or is this proposed as examples?
And well, it looks like right next to that one, it's a green one.
Yeah,
perhaps.
So could they not have green bollards like they used to? I'm curious.
This is what they'll look like.
Okay.
Yellow.
And why is that?
It's just what we've used in the area. The color is a simple thing to change.
Is the answer to that they cannot be green?
They can be whatever color you'd like them to be.
That's his question.
That's the answer.
Okay.
Thank you for rephrasing it.
You're welcome.
So that was my first question. My second question is that there's a couple of these units where in the images you showed them, they're side by side, but in another place, one was here and then the other one was spaced farther apart from it. So I'm kind of curious what decides the spacing. Like, why are some close together when you have two, and then two almost looking like there's like 2 feet between it? It might have been on the previous page.
Yeah, yes. Right.
Like this one, it shows the sign in between. Why are they spread apart like that?
Where we can spread them farther apart, we do, just because it's a little bit easier for people to access them. Most of these are in existing planters, or there is an ADA issue with access to them, so we try and concentrate them so that you're not cutting a planter apart further. The intent is for ease of use for the general public on a crowded day. That's why we're adding one. We've had single ones in the past and they've gotten busy. So it really has to do more, not so much with, has to do with the space available to put mm-hmm. them in mm-hmm. without adding plant area or impacting existing landscaping or anything like that.
So the last question I have, I said I only had two, but I have a third one now. And the third question just is, these all look so realistic in terms of the way they've been presented. Are any of these actually already been installed in the district?
Yes, they have. So we're before you somewhat after the fact and somewhat proposing. We replaced some of these several years ago. We did not come back to the advisory boards. We didn't. Mm-hmm. It was a mistake on our part. We didn't think we needed to. We went from something big and large and giant to something small and out of the way, and then after the fact we were informed that we needed to come back and get advisory board permission. So in some of these locations there are single units. Some of them were proposing two units, so we're trying to show you what was there before, what is proposed. There is a single unit in some of these locations at this time.
Okay, so probably for your presentation, it probably would have helped us just to know which ones on those little site plans, how many of those actually were in place already. But I guess I'll assume that a good percentage of those are.
There are some in each of those lots, mm-hmm. and some of them are doubling up. So okay. Each lot has one. There's no more of these.
Gotcha. Okay. Thank you.
Commissioner Mahan, any questions?
These don't take the folded dollar bills anymore. just a credit card.
They also take flat dollar bills, too. They take... They take actual money as well.
And what about the lighting?
The lighting, it depends on some of the units are solar powered and some of them are hardwired. The hardwired ones are illuminated at all times. The solar powered ones for just the conservation of the battery, they go off and you have to touch the screen for them to come on. Mm-hmm. That was a comment from the commenter, and we've got a letter here today addressing those mm-hmm. operational issues.
Someplace here, there's a, where is it? One, there, yeah, here we go. Page two. Is a thing that says pay here. Is that considered a pole sign? Do you think that's a pole sign?
Mm-hmm. At 108 inches, yes.
Yes. What's our, I guess it's a question to staff. What is the height? What's our?
Maximum height is 6 feet, I believe.
Five?
Five. Is that to the top of the sign or to the top of the pole?
Top of the sign.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Those are my questions.
Commissioner Drury, any questions?
Yeah, referring to that letter by Ms. McKinney, are these new ones like the ones at UCSB, which seem to be pretty simple?
Yes, I believe they're the same units.
And just on a personal thing, how many staff are you letting go because of these kiosks being closed?
We haven't let any full-time staff go. We have seasonal staff, and we've reduced the number of seasonal staff that we use, and then what we call hourlies here in the city, part-time staff. Over the last few years,
is that a budgetary idea? I mean, are restraints because of budget?
Yes, exactly.
Be more efficient. Okay, thank you.
Do we even have purview over these in that they're solar collectors?
What?
That would just be the solar collector portion of it,
oh,
right?
Okay.
that brings up the question that I had. What, just for instance, okay, Ledbetter is not in our purview. Harbor West is not.
These are.
The Cabrillo Garden, or the garden. How many of those are solar, and how many of those are hardwired?
Zero
or solar, so they're all hardwired. Okay.
The solar units are on Cabrillo East and Cabrillo West lots.
The ones near the Art Pavilion. Okay. And how many of those are solar? All. Okay, so if we go back to here,
by the way,
we've
can you
got
turn
three
on your mic?
Pardon?
Just she should have her mic on the
oh. We've got we've
no
got
worries.
Three
there
solar on the west and two solar on the east. Now, my understanding is that some of these are installed, and that's that picture. Those solar panels look like they're flat, or that they're horizontal, or excuse me, parallel to the ground.
Not 100% parallel. I believe they're
okay.
Angled a little bit.
Okay.
They're not
as angled as they're showing.
Yeah,
the
not
picture.
As the straight up and ones,
okay.
Up and down ones.
Okay. Then my last question is that this has been agendized as having six new ADA access ramps.
These are installed with ADA access.
So where then are your ADA access ramps being installed, and what material are you using, and how are you doing that?
These are almost all of these are set in concrete in existing planters where there was concrete or where these previous ones were to begin with. So, for example, here's the best example I can show you. This one is set back with this grated down flush so a wheelchair could take access up to it. This one is already flat. This one is already flat. It's in an area that's at grade. This one is not ADA compliant.
So they're not necessarily ADA access ramps, they're just ADA compliant.
ADA compliant, but we do curb cuts in front of them. So for example, when they go in a planter bed and there's a curb all the way around it, sometimes we cut out the curb and put in the city standard ramp up to it. So,
like where?
It doesn't show in these photographs.
I just showed you.
You need to show us that. If that's part of the project, we need to see that.
It would be Harbor West lot.
Did you do it?
Yes, that is also one.
This is
what
one.
What page is that?
It's page six.
Some of them are on the Harbor West lot, the ABR lot.
Yeah, we're just interested in the HLC purview.
No.
Here we are at Chase Palm Park. Looking at the other side down.
Page
eight.
Not this one.
Location to already
have a curb cut. Let me go back one page, please.
Sure.
On page nine.
So you're not doing a curb cut to those?
No. And these were already at grade, already at the elevation of the asphalt, didn't need them. And this is Cabrillo West.
So actually, why doesn't that one get a cut? If the others all need it, how come these don't require it?
You can roll right up to it.
Oh,
so okay. If you can get up to it and flatten, you can do it. Some of them, they're set back further in the planter bed, and that's why you would need them. And okay. Same with these are at that grade. And the same here, there's no curb cut on these. There is access to them. You can roll right up
so
to them.
So you need to make the plans clarify where you're doing, where you're changing the curb. I'm not seeing that on the plans at all. That was a comment. Any other questions?
I have a question.
Yes, mm-hmm. Commissioner Vena.
Okay. Here comes a mother with 3 or 4 kids, okay? And she doesn't have her husband with her. And she's got to go find one of these things to go over there and take her flock with her to be able to discern what she's got
to
do.
She certainly doesn't want to leave them locked in the car.
In the meantime, it's pouring rain. In the meantime, it's pouring rain. So it seems to me that we're losing a lot of human contact here just for the sake of automating it, and we're not bringing anything to the public that we should be bringing as far as extending some kind of welcome in that case. And the other is, like I say, there's no protection in case of rain, and you're stuck there trying to figure out what you're going to do with your machine, what you're going to do, and you're fumbling through your purse or what have you, and you're getting drenched. So what do you do for that?
The kiosks haven't been manned for years. They were only manned on the weekends. They were never manned during the week.
Mm-hmm.
And on special events, I believe they were manned at those times. So it's always been open access to the environment to go and fold a dollar bill and put it in for many, many years, long before I started working here. Mm-hmm. You bring up some good points, but we have no provision for what you suggest. If a young family shows up on a rainy day, or anybody does, they're expected to go up there and...
or even a handicapped person, you know, you're in your wheelchair moving over there, and you're trying to get to your stuff, and it's not always very convenient. You're pulling out whatever you need to do, and you're trying to make contact with that. In the meantime, you're trying to do that, hold an umbrella, trying to maintain your stability. I think there's some missing items that we're missing here that are not being considered as far as some of the general public is concerned. You may be supplying the ADA concern as far as rolling up, but once you roll up there, you're just there.
That also sort of begs the question, too, is that are these really ADA compliant? Because in order to, you know, read what you're doing and read what the next prompt is, you're up at, I would say, maybe 39 inches. The keypad height is 54 inches. I don't think that complies with ADA. Am I wrong?
The dimensions shown on there all comply with ADA.
They do.
Guidelines, yes.
Okay. I mean, in terms of somebody sitting in a wheelchair looking at a screen?
Yeah, I mean, I've looked at those screens, and if you're off-center just a little bit, you can't even read those screens.
The sun's shining on them.
Yeah. Anyway, that's you know, a comment. Okay, so.
Comments?
I'm going
to start. We're verging.
I diverge. Commissioner Drury, do you have any comments?
Well, I think there's a sort of a sympathy for human contact and the lack of such. But I understand that these kiosks have been, I know they're not manned, although is it my understanding that the harbor east is going to be unmanned also? Is the one that there's a breakwater cafe, and is that going to remain manned?
We refer to that lot as the harbor main lot.
Okay.
It is a 24/7 lot for slip holders and everything else.
Right.
It will remain manned 24 hours a day.
Okay, thank you.
That'll be the only manned kiosk, and as well on Stearns Wharf, we'll also personnel will staff that at all when the wharf's open for vehicles.
Well, that was a question and a comment.
You have a comment?
I don't.
Okay,
thank you,
Mahan.
I'm appalled that these have been put in without coming to the commission. That the city doesn't go by the rules that it requires all of the private people to do. That they're just appalling. These, in terms of El Pueblo Viejo, these are very, these just don't fit, and they're very ugly. When I came to Santa Barbara 55 years ago, the thing that affected me the most was that there were no parking meters on the streets. Mm. I thought, you know, this is a town that welcomes people. This is just wrong. It's just wrong. And I'll tell you what, it's just a creeping thing. Next they'll be on the wharf, and then they'll be in the parking structures. I'm opposed to this. I could not approve this program. I think these things should be taken out.
Can you oppose it on an aesthetic principle?
I oppose it on an aesthetic. Yes, these devices do not conform to El Pueblo Viejo guidelines.
Very good. Thank you. Commissioner Winnick, please. Comments?
Yeah, I can't resist saying it. I've been seeing these in small photographs. I finally realized what their design intention was. The company that designed them, they're meant to look like parking meters. It struck me before I heard that, like when you look at it in the small thing, I just couldn't resist, in a small image like that, it looks like a parking meter. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, it doesn't have the scale of a parking meter. So not to say I'm in favor of parking meters, but that was their design inspiration.
I was kind of getting into the brass tacks of it and some of the questions I asked. Certainly, I think I have problems with the whole program, but in specifically, you know, the colors and things like that seemed insensitive to me too. It was like having yellow when we always use Malaga green in the district. It just seems really not paying attention to the guidelines at all. So I would say that if a project goes ahead, it should definitely conform with the standards of the district. I have no idea how the meter itself, the device, conforms with, you know, standards of the district, though. So I think that'll be your challenge.
Commissioner Lavoie.
I agree, and I would add the signage being proposed and the little solar collectors on top.
Are what?
Are not acceptable under the aesthetic guidelines of the HLC and the ordinance.
Okay. Commissioner Rios?
Well, I keep waiting for them to take off.
We could only pray.
Yeah, right. I can't support this at all, and I looked for ways to try and support it, and if you are not, you have to do this, then the council says yes, we're going to do it. Then I would place these things far away from the public roadways so that they're within the parking lot and somewhat hidden. I would go with the park and walk to get what you have to get and watch for the view from the roads. The Ballards, green, they need lighting. Even the kiosks, for me, when I drive up, because my back is very bad, I have a hard time reaching for the ticket sometimes. And to have them anywhere where there's access and people can park behind you waiting to get in, I often have to stop the car and get out and take care of the matter. And if there's cars behind me, they're not thrilled. So there's a lot of problems I see with this, and the design is not acceptable in El Pueblo Viejo. Pole signs are not acceptable. If you want to get rid of the kiosks, I think what Sherry Lee suggested about recycling them is a good idea, but this is not the way I want Santa Barbara to be at all. I'm sorry. It's just not right.
Commissioner Vena.
Well, I've already stated the protection as far as some kind of shelter is concerned. The other is, other than aesthetics and so forth, I don't think they're very friendly. I think that as people get older, they have a harder time figuring things out, and I think we have to consider some of those things. I don't think that automation is necessarily the best thing in all cases. I think, Graham, we're just getting more robotized as we go.
Okay. I'm going to go back to a question before I make my comments. Have you researched any other type of dispensers, whether they be, rather than pay and display, pay per space, so you enter your numbered space in, and that way you don't have to go back and forth from the pay station to the car. Have you researched any other types, maybe more user-friendly, more aesthetic?
Yes, we have.
That's fine. You've answered the question then. On an aesthetic level, these do not conform to the district's guidelines, so I couldn't support them. You're going to need to do something that make these fit within our guidelines. Commissioner LaVoie.
I make a motion for an indefinite continuance, directing the applicant to restudy the proposal so that it is more in keeping with the HLC guidelines. And I would point out some other examples, exercises that this commission has gone through to make things that are generally unacceptable acceptable. One of the more successful ones was the bicycle bolts, which we did considerable study on and proposals, and merely with a little bit of paint and the right color, made something that was pretty ugly, pretty acceptable. I looked at one this morning in a parking garage and actually thought that was successful. There are ways of conforming to the ordinance that aren't always difficult.
We need a simpler motion than that.
I'm sorry?
A simpler motion.
A simpler motion. And that was a long motion.
That was a long motion. indefinite continuance. Or 2 weeks if you want to come back in 2 weeks. With a redesign more appropriate to the HLC guidelines.
Okay.
Sign ordinance and city sign design program recently adopted.
All right, second.
Okay. So we have a motion by LaVoie, a second by Winnick under discussion.
Yeah.
I want to also say, and I didn't get a chance to say it, Mr. Mahan came across pretty clearly on it, but the fact that these had been installed without this commission's review and ABR's review, I'm assuming, is appalling and very disappointing. The city of Santa Barbara holds us professionals to a very high standard, and if they can't meet that standard, then what's the point of me meeting that standard? I'm not here to berate you. You didn't make that decision, but I think it needs to go on record that this sets a really, really bad example and bad precedent. I mean, I can't think of anything worse. If the maker of the motion and the second of the motion would like to put that in the motion, that would be great. If not, I'm fine with that too, but I just needed to say my piece.
Mr. Chair?
Commissioner Drury, under discussion.
No, this is just this has gone to the point where we're losing the human touch because the kiosks are not staffed. And there's obviously a great deal of money generated by parking that used to be free. And I think that the whole program is a terrible program for Santa Barbara, for not the tourists so much, but just for the people who get off work and want to come down to East Beach and walk in the sand, and they have to go through this whole rigmarole with their kids. A pay program would be more acceptable to me if it was staffed by people and not these ugly machines. And I think it's something that Santa Barbara, as Commissioner Mahan said, when he didn't see parking meters here those many years ago, this is something that speaks to the quality of the beach experience in Santa Barbara. And I would love to see the kiosk staffed or free parking in reinstituted across the city in Santa Barbara.
Mr. Chair.
We have a motion. We have a second under discussion. Commissioner?
As maker of the motion, to modify the motion to direct staff to list this as a violation mitigation, in part, identifying those sites in particular which were installed without review.
Seconder of the motion okay with that?
I'll second that.
Okay. All right, any other discussion?
Mr. Chair,
yes, under discussion, Commissioner Mahan.
I would like, when the applicant comes back, I would like for them to have run this by the handicapped people. There used to be an organization here in town of handicapped people. I used to come in at ABR when I was there and check out things, and I think we need to run it by them. I don't believe these things are handicapped accessible. And I believe in the wrong light, they will not be able to see these screens from there. Okay. From their wheelchair or glaring sunlight or whatever it is. You even have a hard time, you know, checking at the filling station when the sun is wrong, mm-hmm. trying to see what's in that screen.
Do you want to make that part of the motion? Are you requesting that?
I'm suggesting that that be put into the motion.
Does the maker of the motion want to?
Yeah, I'll be very specific that in the this accessibility group evaluate one of the existing installations.
Okay. Make seconder.
And provide us their feedback, please.
Is there a specific group?
I think it's called the Accessibility Group. Accessibility Advisory Board.
Yes.
Accessibility. Okay. Fine. I'm fine. You can
okay.
add it.
We're not twisting your arm. All right.
I might not have seconded.
No. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Abstain.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Aye.
Okay, next item on the agenda is item 5. It's final review for 420 East Annapamoose Street. This is a proposal to demolish an existing 259-square-foot one-car garage and construct two new residential condominium units above three new two-car garages as an addition to the rear of Unit A. Final approval is requested. Project requires compliance with Staff Hearing Officer Resolution Number 008-07. Project was last reviewed on March 27th, 2007. I will read those comments.
March 7th, 2007.
8 years ago. 8.5 years ago. It's unbelievable.
I'll find out.
Thank you.
There was a preliminary approval and continued definitely to the consent calendar for final approval with the following comments. Restudy the proportions of the scope of the balcony railings, keeping in mind the dramatic and broad proportion of the existing railings and beams. The tree at the end of the driveway shall be a large, tall tree. Motion was made by Pujo, was seconded by Naylor. It was a 4-0-2 vote. Adams and Sharp abstained. Murray stepped down. House was absent. Motion carried. I doubt you were here.
Yeah.
I wasn't here either.
All right, please introduce. I'm sorry, are there staff comments here?
Suzanne Riegel, case planner for the project. Just a brief background on this. This project has a tentative subdivision map that was approved back in January of 2007, due to time extensions by the state's governor, and one city granted 2-year time extension, the project is still a viable project going forward, and will expire. The tentative map will expire January 31st of 2018. We do have a provision in our ordinance that says that all design review will run with the longest land use approval, and that is why this project is before you today for final approval only.
Okay. Please introduce yourself to the record and give us a brief presentation.
I'm Jarrett Gorn from Vanguard Planning.
I'm Jeff Weinstein, architect with Hustle Construction.
Welcome.
Okay, so this is a fully approved condo project at 420 East Annapamoo, and the project has a new owner now, and they have made some really minor exterior changes, specifically to the balcony rails, I think consistent with the comments that you just read back. I didn't bring a printout of the original approval, but I do have, I've got those plans here. I don't know if these are going to show up on the monitor or not.
Mm-hmm. Well, they show up really well.
So this is the original approval, and you can see that that original approval has the stucco siding, and it's got this open picket railing on all of the rails, and that's what's being changed now. And
put that back.
Oh, sure.
Please.
Oops. Put it back, please.
I'm sorry. My bad.
He didn't mean to.
This.
Can you just point at one of the ones that are changing?
Yeah. These railings here. So from this point forward is all the original house, which is all retained and not being changed as part of the project. And then
to go in that direction.
And then everything in back is the new condos in the interior portion of the lot. And then these are all the original railings which were proposed, which are these open pickets.
You should show the railings from the original house.
Right. Well, we've got photos of that, which we submitted. And do you have those photos?
It's on the plan. It should be on that.
We have on there, too. But the photos of the actual house that I took are larger, and I want to look at those.
There you go. It does look well. It's the right size. Next will be, he's got an Apple Watch. Next will just put your watch.
No, they're there. On 8.5 by 11. Okay. Yeah, those are mine right there. Can I have those photos real quick?
Sure.
Okay, I'll copy that here.
Okay, so sorry about the lighting on this.
This is.
Yeah, that's a good one too. Better lighting. Yeah.
Was the neighborhood?
Oh, they're solid.
Yeah. So the original house, which is the thing with the character that people were concerned about out here, has these solid railings with this detail on them, and that's what's visible from the street. And then these condos are proposed back in the back of a lot. Okay. And the change to the railings that the new owner is proposing is to make the other railings basically match that. I'm going to go find some elevation drawings. This is a big plan set because it's for final, and I don't have all the sheets memorized. See, that's the side opposite the rails. Here they are.
Sheet A-5.2. A-5.2.
So these same railings originally were open pickets, and now they're this solid detail with the same scoop thing and matching what's on the house.
Mm-hmm. Let's compare some city TV, if you could zoom in, please. Not that part.
There you, got your
there
you
go.
Oh, you know what? Actually, this one's almost better because it's better scale. Thanks.
Let me actually. Sorry, City TV. Hold on 1 second.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they are different.
Okay.
And that's really it.
The change.
That's the exterior change that's proposed. And then we've now gotten materials picked out, and here's a materials board. So it's a composition roof shingle. That's the garage door. This is the stucco color. Is that integral color stucco?
Yes.
This is the trim color. That is the window material and color. They're Anderson clad windows, and that's the actual material and color.
To match the trim.
To match the trim. This is a solid wood front door from, is it Colby?
It's on the back.
Cobb. We have everything labeled on the back of this here. If you guys want to put that in your motion or anything. But it is a
it's theirs to keep.
TM Cobb.
Mm-hmm.
And then, I'm sorry, if you flip that back over, the light fixture, that's the light fixture.
Okay.
Does that conclude your presentation?
That concludes my presentation, unless you have any questions for us.
Oh, we're going to get to that. I've got to open public comment, so I'll open public comment. I do not have any speaker slips or correspondence, so I'll close public comment and ask the commission if they have any questions. Commissioner Baina, do you have any questions?
Not at this time, thank you.
Commissioner Arias, Commissioner Lavoie? Any questions?
Only rhetorical ones.
Yeah. Commissioner Winnick, any questions?
You may have said it, but I guess I'm not sure why. Or maybe I wasn't listening. What was the reason for wanting to go from the open pickets to the closed railing, side rails?
Because the conditions of approval said the railing should as closely match as possible with existing design.
The microphone.
Oh, yeah.
The conditions of approval said...
Yes, it is.
Yeah, this is on.
He has a soft voice. Yeah.
The conditions of approval said that the railing should as closely match the existing railings in that front house as possible. So that's why we revised the railings, and I just think it makes a better, it's a better solution.
Okay, and those conditions of approval were from some other body, or are they from HLC?
Years ago.
Okay.
Years ago.
Gotcha. All right.
They're on those original plans.
Got rid of the minutes.
Right.
Even.
I'm sorry, I spaced at the beginning.
Okay.
But I still wanted to see it. You'll know why I asked the question, but thank you.
Commissioner Mahan, questions?
Yeah, well, the question then, just to follow up, is if they're supposed to match the railing on the front, why aren't they designed to match it? Instead of, I mean, the proportions are wrong, the
detailing, the cap is missing.
Yeah, why not make them match is the question.
We could go into the drawings and see the detail and see if it has that cap that you describe.
What page would that be?
It doesn't show up in the elevations.
We've got 53 sheets here.
So. Yeah.
So these CDs are not completed, so I don't see a detail highlighting a section through those railings.
Arc, it's either going to be on 9.1, 2, or 3.
9.1.
9.2 or 9.3.
I see them here. I'm looking upside down.
Not there.
I think you're right. I don't see them either.
Is your intent then to more closely match?
Well, you know, now that I saw the, is there anything on here?
Not detailed.
So when you had that visual up there, and you had that little cap, and you had the little cap, I think that would make a nice enhancement to the the railing to put that little cap that's kind of highlighted.
City TV, please zoom in. Thank you. Talking about this cap.
Yes,
here.
I think we can replicate that on the balconies at the
into
condo.
That curve.
But I don't know about the curve, I'll be honest with you. Take a look at this curve. It's rather dramatic and goes high up the post, which is kind of a little different situation than we have on the condo.
Here,
so I don't know that.
The issue with that curve, if I may, is that this house was built before building code requirements that we have.
City TV, please zoom out.
Okay, on all of these balconies, we've got a 42-inch minimum height requirement on our railing, and if we go and match this proportion with the 42-inch height requirement on the bottom portion of this, we're going to have top parts that stick way too high on all of these railings. I think that's what we're going to end up seeing, and I think that is precisely why they didn't do it. If you look at the height of this railing down here on this porch, you can see it's probably 10 inches shorter or 8 inches shorter than the railing on the rest of the balconies, and that's why the proportion is different. I think it might look really strange if we try to do it exactly. And or we can't do it exactly.
Okay, Commissioner Drury, any questions?
Yeah, do you have any drawings that or mock-ups that show what is visible from the street behind the existing house? So that that's the okay. All right, thank you.
All right. Comments. Commissioner Vena, any comments?
What is this tree that's being removed over here in the back portion of the...
What sheet are you on?
On L2.1. It says remove existing tree. What are we removing there? If you may. You just identify them to be removed, but you don't identify what they are or how big they are.
There you go. 2.1, did you say?
It says L2.1.
Existing tree.
Big tree. Yeah.
See, so this is a tree at the rear of the property, and this is a tree that you're referring to.
I don't know exactly what species of tree that is. It's all ornamental trees that are back there. I have a photo in the back of the property that I took that probably shows that tree.
I see this one here.
Yeah, I don't know exactly what that is. I mean, there's nothing in this project that is any different than the approved project.
Yeah, I think that's already been reviewed. And if I remember correctly, I think it was a citrus tree.
Okay.
Like an orange or a lemon. I'm not positive which one. Any comments, Commissioner Arias?
No, not really.
Okay. Commissioner Lavoie, comments?
I don't know where to begin. Can I have the pointer, please, and a photograph of the front of the existing house?
Does this work for you?
That works perfectly.
No, that one's better.
That works perfectly. This is an excellent example of what it is. The columns on the corners, the detail of this swooping front, and yes, that swooping front is only 18 inches high. The detail of the wood, how it relates to the beam, the outriggers and their locations and scale and size. When I look at this elevation on sheet A5.2, I don't see any of that. I don't see any of that. Nor do I see a building that I think is an appropriate addition to this historic resource at all. The garage doors, maybe. And yes, it received approval how many years ago. I can't vote in favor of this project. And you need to look at the detailing. These are just boilerplate. Yeah, but it's not showing up in the elevation drawings.
No, you're right. It's not showing up in the elevation. I looked at the.
And the intent of the elevation drawings is to have a cap on it, then it needs to be drawn that way. Not being told that in some future set of drawings we're going to see a cap.
I know, really, my eyes.
Mr. Chair, I have a point of order question.
Okay, Commissioner Rios.
This project was. Make sure I'm wrong. This project was last seen in 2007, and we are in 2015. Uh-huh. I wasn't on the commission then.
None of us were.
None of us were alive.
Yes, well, I was.
So I think Ms. Regal sort of explained that and
so
why.
Hasn't the approval expired?
No, it hasn't.
It hasn't expired, but usually we're required to review the minutes or look at the TV thing and,
Ms. Regal, will you please elaborate on why this is...
No, it hasn't expired.
Why this hasn't expired.
Well, I think why we who have not been on the committee can review it without proper... We have a policy of reviewing things and watching the TV and reading the minutes and...
Just,
we don't.
I did want to. I don't think it's been brought up, but there was a historic structures report completed on this as well, completed by Fermina Murray, that we can make available to you as well.
2 years ago.
That was in 2007. That's why the purview came over here from ABR because HLC found that it was significant in concurrence with the structures report, so it went onto the potentials list. It was before split at the ABR.
Commissioner Jury?
Just a point of
order.
Of order. Since they received, this is a final approval, so they've gone as far as the last step before our time.
And it seems that we have to be fair to the applicant because they have provided what's necessary. I think if there's drawings that are lacking, that they should provide those too. But we have to be a little open to the fact that these many years ago, when I was a child, really, this project came before the Landmarks Commission. That's all I have to say about that.
Mr. Chair.
Commissioner Mayer.
Because I hadn't seen this before, I don't want to make any comments on it, but I would suggest that we continue it. We have seen it now, and if we continue it for 2 weeks, then we can take an action on it.
Can I
in the meantime, then the applicant could flesh out the details so that we can see what we're approving.
Commissioner Winnett.
Yeah, I'd like to make a couple comments beforehand, too. So, and thanks for bringing up, Commissioner Reyes, bringing up that question of, you know, our purview, since we weren't literally sitting here, most of us. And I do want to question something that was in the minutes last time that was a recommendation, because maybe what we're seeing is an idea that was suggested, albeit 8 years ago, that maybe didn't play out so well. And I'd like to question the direction to try to match the original railings. I think that that's not successful, what I'm seeing here. Mm-hmm. And I think Mr. Gorin shared a pretty good description of why it still might not be successful, even if we suggest that the applicant follow the detailing. I think it might be better to have these as open railings. They could still have a curb and what have you, but not try to duplicate the original railings, because I don't think they will ever look like the original railings. They'll be a bad parody of the original railings. So I think in some ways, now that you've studied that, we'd be better off not doing that and letting it be more akin to what was previously proposed. And then I would say, please do go back and study and try to look at the eaves and the detailing to make it more compatible, since that's part of final review, is submitting final details that refine the project. So I think that's still consistent with your previous approval, so it would just be to refine the details. So anyway, that's what I would offer. I don't know if the commission will agree with me, but I think that these railings don't have a chance of looking good in the way they are.
I would definitely concur with that that assessment. I don't think you could ever make these railings, because of current building codes, look as elegant as the original ones. And if that happens, then there's really no point in doing it, trying to make them look. So whether they go back to open railing, or whether you come up with something, a solid railing that would work, that's up to you. But I think we need to sort of retract that statement that they more closely or
exactly. I actually think they could be made to work.
Could you?
Yeah. I mean, just the plaster section of the rail would be at the height more in proportion to the originals, and then what's above that is a transparent rail. I mean, the reason why that works is the fact it's so low to the ground. It's not it wasn't meant to be a restraining rail. It's only a porch rail that's 18 inches
almost
above the ground. It is a seat wall.
No, but there's another reason, if you don't mind my breaking in. Look at the width. Mm-hmm. It's a singular, very large statement. These don't have the same breadth. They don't have the same width. So I think it's going to be hard to pull off the proportions. I'm not saying that you have to go back to the first railings. I just think that trying to emulate this railing in this proportion space.
And I think the applicant gets it. So I don't think,
I
don't think that we need to elaborate on the railings any more.
I think it's much more than that.
Yeah, it is more than that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Any other comments, Commissioner Drury?
How wide is the porch, the front porch?
No, it's at least 18 feet.
At least. So that
8 feet from him.
That railing is meant for people to sit down.
Yeah, it's a seat wall.
And look out. It's not a.
Or look back in. Yeah, right.
Yeah. Whatever. Okay, thank you.
Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion for a 2 weeks continuance for the applicant to restudy the railings.
Anything else that he needs to restudy?
Well, let's just ask this. Well, do you mind if we keep it for discussion? Since the applicant didn't bring a materials board, should we at least say if we see it going in the right direction or if there's anything they should be working on at this time? I didn't see any exceptions.
I don't. Make a motion, want to add anything, whether it's acceptable or needs more study.
This is going to be the color of the new stucco,
mm-hmm.
And the existing building is what?
It looks like a green color,
a whitish.
Or just we could ask them just to bring back the colors.
I would like to see some felt pen colors put on the elevations to see if that works with the brown on the back and the white on the front.
Okay.
And I'll second the motion.
Wait, so the motion is a 2 week continuance to restudy the railing details and to provide
rendering
color information on the elevations.
Yeah.
And I'd second by
paint color information on the elevations.
Appreciate if the maker of the motion would entertain a couple other comments.
Yes.
One would be,
what are those?
Please bring a sample of the to match the existing paint color for reference. And then also not only study the railing details, but further detail the eaves and any of the elements that would make the building more compatible with the existing building as part of your final detailing.
Yeah, I accept
that. Can I ask one question on your motion, which would help us? Can mm-hmm. your motion specifically include language specific to that condition, which is directing us to match those railings? Could you say that? It isn't critical for us to match those railings in our study of these new ones.
Sure.
Yes.
So you were actually the maker, but I could try.
Yes. Restudy the railings.
I think that's sufficient.
Restudy the railings.
Okay. It supersedes the previous.
Yeah. Okay.
Cool.
All right. So we had a motion by Mahan, a second by Winnick. Any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain.
Abstain.
One abstention by Lavoie. Motion carries. You understand?
Yep, totally.
Okay, good. That's the way
weeks.
I like it.
There you go.
Okay, we'll hold.
Well, they should take that back so they can return with it.
We're going to take that. We're going to take the photos.
Yes.
Well, there's duplicate sets. They can keep
that's
one.
Okay, we had duplicate sets.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Next item on the agenda is
final.
Item
Here's
six.
Another one over here.
This is a sign review for 211 West Carrillo Street.
Joanna?
Oh, God.
This is a proposal for one new 5.6 square foot non-illuminated wood projecting sign, one new 5.6 square foot non-illuminated wood wall sign, and two new 2.8 square foot non-illuminated vinyl digital print window signs on an existing commercial building. The total proposed signage is 16.8 square feet. Total allowable signage for this location is 45 square feet. This is a review after final be requested for proposed changes to vinyl window signs, paint color, and border trim. Project was last reviewed on October 21st, 2015. I will read those comments. I think.
Motion.
No,
that's not it.
Yeah, this was last reviewed at sign consent. Final approval as submitted. It was Schallenberger and Cope. It was a 200 vote. Motion carried.
Yeah, so I just want to make a comment. This was brought back forward to the commission. I think it was reviewed by the commission on September 23rd.
Yes, it was.
And there was a comment specific to the window signs. The final approval as submitted set from consent had silhouetted letters in the window. And now the applicant is returning with a proposal that doesn't really speak to that condition from the September 23rd approval, and that's why we brought it back to the commission since it was a commission-specific comment.
So the last page, south elevation, is what's being proposed that's different from the sign committee approval?
Yes, that and the border color change, but I guess the applicant can go through the presentation.
Okay. All right. We'll let the applicant make his presentation, and we'll go from there. Please introduce yourself for the record.
Vasant Tham from Visual Image Design.
Welcome.
We installed the sign as requested by the committee last time, and I just took a picture of the sign, and this is what was requested. And
I hope you don't get a bad text.
Okay.
We can zoom in a little bit there.
So it's on the wood.
That's the actual sign.
Yes.
Can you zoom out?
So no blue border.
No blue border.
Quit turning it around because it needs to stay on.
Okay.
Sorry.
I think he was turning it so it would become larger, but that's okay.
Oh.
You know how it does that? Yeah.
Tilt it.
But it's not doing it. There you go. Right. There you go.
Perfect.
Okay.
She's sure you're getting a lot of advertising here.
Okay. We have about 5 viewers right now.
It's that.
And 3 of them wouldn't think of going.
Hey, Kellum, hope you're watching.
All right, please continue.
I hit the sign, and my customer is not happy, and he's complaining to me, he doesn't like the border. So I said, okay, I'll go back to the city and find out if I can at least make you happy by giving you.
Can you move that microphone?
You have to move it in closer.
All right.
Yeah.
There you go.
So that's why I'm requesting the blue border. And then for the window one, I'll show you again. He's saying it's not visible enough. So it's a small one. If you can at least see, this is what I did. At least have that small digital print to match, to be consistent with the rest of the signs.
So what's being proposed? That's what's done.
That's what was approved, and that's what's been done right now.
Right. And now you're proposing
this one.
We'd get some sort of backing.
So this digital print on. Okay.
So it would have yellow behind it. Would just be letters on the window.
How tall are the letters? On the proposed window sign?
4.2 inches.
4.2.
Yes.
It's supposed to be 4, I think, right?
Okay.
And 4 is the limit.
All right, so he's close. We could stipulate 4 easily.
All right. Does that conclude your presentation?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I will open public comment. I have no speaker slips, so I'll close public comment. Ask the commission if they have any questions. Commissioner Vena, Commissioner Rios, Commissioner Lavoie, Commissioner Winnick, Commissioner...
Well, I'll just ask the one. You were proposing 4.2 on the letter sizes. I believe 4.0 would be what's acceptable. Okay. Would that be okay?
I'm okay with that.
Okay. Thank you.
Commissioner Mahan.
No questions.
Commissioner Drury. Okay. Comments? Commissioner Vena.
No comment.
Commissioner Rios. Commissioner Lavoie, any comments?
I don't think the switching to a blue frame will change much, if anything. But not the window sign. I wouldn't support the window sign.
Okay. Commissioner Winnick.
I guess I would support the proposed changes because I'm thinking it's what I'm seeing here was scale-wise and size is certainly, I think it's done respectfully. It's not done in an abrasive way.
It's a 13-inch.
Yeah, no, I'm just so I could support it.
Commissioner Mahan?
I can support it.
Commissioner Drury.
I agree. I think it's very restrained. I would support
it. Okay. Any other comment? All right. What's the pleasure of the commission?
Well, I guess since I started the ball rolling, I'll make a motion. So this doesn't have to go back to the sign committee, I'm assuming?
No, you can have final approval.
Okay. Final design approval with one revision. So as proposed, final design approval with the one revision that the window signs be maximum letter size of 4.0, not 4.2
inches
tall.
Okay.
And I think that's it.
A motion by Winnick, a second by Mahan. Under discussion?
No, it was Drury. Drury seconded.
Oh, I'm sorry, Drury. Second by Drury.
And actually, I'd like to just add one little thing to the motion before we finish, and that is that final approval was based on the opinion that the signage has been done in a modest way. It's not
you agree
oversized.
With that, Commissioner Drury? Okay. Under discussion, any other discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Opposed.
One opposition? Lavoie? Abstain? No abstention. Motion carries. You understand the motion?
Yes. This can be appealed.
This decision, our decision today, can be appealed to the City Council within 10 days of today's date.
By me?
By
anybody.
By you or...
Or somebody that was opposing
the public.
It.
Okay. Anybody who objects.
So don't do anything, right?
You don't need to do anything.
Okay.
Okay. Don't appeal it.
Okay. No.
All right. All right. Are we finished with today's business?
Thank you so much.
Meeting adjourned.
Yes.
Thank you.
Since this is the perfect spot to learn, teach me tonight, starting with the ABC of it, right down to the XYZ of it. Help me solve the mystery of it. Teach me tonight. The sky's a blackboard high above you. If a shooting star goes by, I'll use that star